Ms. Drea. Sitting here staring at the wall. Tea cap telling me to carry on. Cause you win some, you lose some, but you live. But you live.
I'm your host, Ms. Drea. And here with me, I have my beautiful co-host,
Davia, the Wonder Twins.
And here with us, we have two gentlemen, one by the name of Tyrone to my left and Kevin to my right. First off, I want to welcome you guys to the show. How are you? Welcome.
Thank you.
You're welcome. Pleasure. You're welcome. It's a pleasure to have you both on and talk about these heavy subjects that we're talking about today.
Please tell us
a little bit about yourself, starting with you, Tyrone.
Again, Tyrone A. Jackson. Live here in Miami, Florida. Daytime was system administrator with the government, dealing with assisting them dealing with human trafficking, labor trafficking, anti-terrorism,
okay.
And we do humanitarian aid to the Latin American countries. So this type of subject matter is very sensitive to me.
Wow.
Okay.
Okay. And you, Kevin?
So I created a community in Hollywood called the Light Beings Community, and I designed my own practice that teaches how to live in a more empowered state in your life. So how to live from creatorhood, how to recognize that you have the ability to choose for yourself, how to shift old traumas, how to develop emotional intelligence, how to restore old wounds and restore human connection, and all of like those different dynamics of how we function in behavior and as a species, really. So I teach a lot of things around that.
All right.
So Drea, he really fits for this conversation, right? To kind of segue back into that conversation.
Okay, period. So hearing about the topics that we've discussed, emasculation of the black man, and let's just first touch on that. What are some of you guys' views on that subject?
Do you want to start or you want to go into it?
Well, I think it's a major issue on so many fronts that it change the dynamics of our association with one another, and it put us in more of a going down the road of a chaos, mm-hmm. where we're confused, we don't know who we are, where we come from, and we don't know where we're going, but we are so self-centered, mm-hmm. so focused on ourselves that we don't have appreciation for anything except if it just pertains to us, mm-hmm. and that's what I see with this confusion, mm-hmm. as a whole.
Okay.
What I see in a situation like this, and any situation similar, is the nature of the psyche and how we function as a people. And since a society is just a relationship between people, mm-hmm. the way that we relate to ourselves then just, you know, magnifies across the board. So when you look at a concept like emasculating a culture or the masculine aspect, there's something underneath it that stems from the idea of, like you mentioned, knowing who you are. Mm-hmm. Right, and there's two things that drive any human being in the human experience, right? And that's significance and safety. Every mm-hmm. single person on the planet wants to feel significant and they want to feel safe.
That's good.
Right, that's what drives them. Now, when you're living from what I call a love perspective, mm-hmm. which is that you know you're significant, you know you're safe just by the fact you exist, or you were brought up in an environment where you were held in a space mm-hmm. to know that you could be more, to know that you matter, you function differently and you know you already are significant and safe, so your choices come from a far more grounded, clear mm-hmm. space, more conscious, more disciplined, and more purposeful.
Right.
When you don't feel significant and safe, or you're raised in an environment where everything is, you know, tumultuous or chaotic, mm-hmm. you don't have that sense of self, and your entire life becomes dedicated to finding that at all cost. Mm-hmm. You want to feel significant, you want to feel safe, you will find anything outside of yourself to do it. So when that happens, Your whole life is always finding that outside of yourself, and so you're so much more easily susceptible mm-hmm. to that. And then when you think of hip hop, how it started, mm-hmm. right? And it was started from men who were very, you know, like, we're gonna get out there, we're gonna speak what's going on from our hearts and get out there, and became this culture that was lyrical and poetic and, you know, like that spoken word aspect of it.
Very conscious.
And it was powerful. And then it became something that could be made a business, mm-hmm. right? Which then money got involved in. And to go back to that same concept, if you don't feel significant and safe, mm-hmm. right, you're going to find a way to do it at all costs. And what's a really good way to do it in our society? Getting money. Mm-hmm. Right? But if you start pursuing that money without a sense of self,
yeah,
right, it costs you.
Exactly.
It costs you. And then that's what we start to witness, because it's the only way anyone would be willing to do something like that. Mm-hmm. Right? It's like how the con game works. You find someone who is emotionally unstable and convince them of something that they desperately want that would give them this idea mm. that would matter. And since lying is a cooperative act, mm. you'll just tell yourself it's okay. and we rationalize our way through it, and then it becomes something as a culture that we just do because we just want to matter. We just want to have something of note. We just want to feel like we're okay. We just want to be accepted. We just want to whatever. And these things underneath what we see is actually what's causing the perpetuation of it.
And you know, it's so funny the whole time you're hearing that, because you're saying significance and safety. I'm going to ask something about that later. But just even thinking about commentary, when you think about how Cardi B has been rising in hip hop and like some of her things, she was like, I'm ready to retire because this is not what I thought it was. And just hearing everything she thought that, you know, getting to this level of success, having attaining this money, obtaining all these things, you know, she thought was going to bring her happiness. And she's still the void. It's still there. And now she was like, I feel more safe out in the hood than I do right now. You know, in that toxic environment. And a lot of times they find safety in that toxicity. You know, so then when you have a paradigm shift and you're not mentally prepared for that, you replicate that which you just came out of.
So, right. And how often do we hear that, right? People who get to that space of fame and stardom, and they're like, this is not what I thought it was. And every race and culture has that experience. Because, you know, Hollywood and entertainment itself is a beast. Like, you see what it does. You look what happens to children who grow up in it.
Oh, yeah. They're
got a sense of self. You know what I mean?
Oh, my gosh.
Yeah. It's an interesting
Poor Raven Simone. I keep her in my prayers often. Speaking of that, when we're talking about the whole component, we brushed on it. When you talk about the connection of the black men, well, I'm not even going to say black, but just general, just how men and women connect each other on a basic human level, establishing relationships. Now, I am speaking from a heterosexual lens, but how do we talk about, how do we not treat each other like we're each other's enemy? Like, how do we create a sense of significance and safety when it comes to building relationships?
Yeah, that's it's an interesting dynamic, and it's the most important focus for us to actually reestablish our species, our society, and the nature of masculine and feminine energy within us. What we've witnessed in the world now is this patriarchal male dominant society, right? But it hasn't been a healthy male dominant society.
Say that.
Right? And we now have thought that this is the idea of what masculine energy is, and then what the idea of feminine energy is, when all we've ever been witnessing is the distortion.
Wow.
Right? And that distortion comes from this idea of wanting to feel significant, right? You want to feel powerful. And so if a male is taught that emotions are a weakness, right? He is already been cut off from a portion of his greater self-knowledge.
Love it.
You know, and his greater access of power. And so when you think of that concept, it's no different than the concept of bullying, where if I don't feel powerful, if I don't feel significant, I have to find a way to do that. And if I can get that from dominating my environment, feeling more above women or other men, that becomes my mechanism. And then that just perpetuates the story again.
Right.
And so then you see that in society where there's this powerful male figures, but that idea of power is actually the distortion.
Wow.
It's wanting to appear that way because underneath it, we really feel weak and scared, and we have no idea how to process it. And then we just start to play out this story. And so we find any way to make ourselves feel like more than we actually feel when we're alone in a room with no one to validate our existence. So that's where that concept of I want to feel like a pimp comes from. That's where that concept of I want to be flashy, because in the dynamic of masculine and feminine energy, in the natural essence of it harmoniously, the partnership of masculine and feminine is essential. It's in all of nature. And it's also the reason why you see how it plays out. Like when you look at species that are just consciously in tune, right? All like animals, for instance. That dynamic of how men function in relation to the female, like wanting to get a female's attention.
Right.
Like, see me, see me, see me. And the woman getting decided, like,
right.
Yeah, you know what? Or they're like, nope, I'm going to this one.
Right.
Then there's this natural flow to that dynamic, and they make it work, right? In our civilization as a human being, we've now stepped into the version of consciousness that gets to choose. So, but it's still in us. So men still want to get women, or, and whether this is, and this is for whether it's homosexuality or heterosexuality, whatever energy is the most dominant, meaning that even in homosexual, there's that dynamic of masculine and feminine. Someone is more male dominant, someone's more female dominant. It's still the same dynamic of see me, I got this, I got what you want. And that plays out. But if the distortion is there, meaning that if you get closer to me and I still don't feel safe enough or significant in myself, I'm going to find ways to do it.
Right.
And so then that dynamic of what we would once have as a support system of men and women becomes a power struggle, because we start seeing it from this idea of what we think is right or wrong, And anytime your only intention is to be right, you miss the point altogether.
Every time. You're not even open. You're not even open.
Right? There's nothing else to talk about.
Nothing.
It's like, if that's all you're interested in, right, you miss the point. And so when we stop talking for a second,
ooh,
and just listen, if we just have a conversation of, how do you feel?
Mm-hmm.
And not how did you make me feel, just right, how do you feel in relation to this?
Mm-hmm.
It opens up a dialogue that changes everything. And it's funny that we can talk about it as men and women, mm-hmm, and masculine and feminine, but that story right there,
mm-hmm,
plays itself out in everything. It's the reason why we have wars.
Yes.
It's the reason why there's gang violence. It's the reason why there's cops shooting unarmed people. There's every single thing that we can associate in our society as an issue,
mm-hmm,
is actually the side effect, mm-hmm, of our inner conflict with ourselves, mm-hmm, of that dynamic.
That's true.
Good.
That's definitely
I'm
true.
Glad we taping this, because I got to sit back and rewind that one.
Yep.
That was off.
Can I add to that?
Go ahead.
I would say, as complimenting what he's saying, one thing I learned a long time ago, when you don't know the purpose of a thing, you're, mm-hmm, subject to abuse it and misuse it.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
So
yes,
if I don't know what my purpose is,
mm-hmm,
then how can I really compliment you?
Mm-hmm.
Exactly.
Right.
And we're not into competition. We're into complimenting.
Mm-hmm.
And when we compliment one another, we strengthen one another, and we can move further, faster,
exactly,
ahead. Mm-hmm. We're, our association is supposed to be like that puzzle, that box of puzzle pieces in a box.
Mm-hmm.
We see what the image is.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
You want to be happy. I want to be happy. I want to be financially stable. You want to be financially stable.
Mm-hmm.
But only way we can get there if we work together. Mm-hmm. We are many pieces of this puzzle, and we got to learn where our place is on that board.
Mm-hmm.
And some people are supposed to be next to you.
Mm-hmm.
It's like, say, you're the centerpiece. Some supposed to be next to you. Some supposed to be on the outer edge.
Right.
But we got the outer edge trying to be in the middle.
Right.
And that's where confusion comes about. And then that confusion comes to chaos.
Mm-hmm.
So we got to get an understanding of who we are. And respectfully, conversate with, find out who you are, what's your likes, what's your dreams, what's your goals,
mm-hmm,
and see how can we complement that.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
But as long as we're at war with one another, we're going to,
yes,
continue to be crabs in that pot.
Yes, goodness.
So I need you just as much as you need me.
Right.
So how can we, yeah, work this out together so we can get to that final destination?
I am, therefore you are. I love
can
it.
Can I add something on that?
Yes, sure.
You guys want to,
yeah, no, you guys,
I love
go
what
ahead.
You shared. That's important. And the way what I teach in my practice, and especially when it comes to relationships, is in like business or any group organization, to work cohesively, it's solution-based thinking.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And when you start getting into the idea of uncovering the most important stage of our next human evolution is actually our ability to feel,
yes,
freely.
Mm-hmm.
We do not allow ourselves to feel freely,
mm-hmm,
because we have such a judgment about emotions, and there's a really important reason why that is.
Mm-hmm.
When you date back to the nature of any civilization, right? We can go 10,000 BC if we want to,
mm-hmm,
but in this all leading up to here, if we've never taken time to understand how we feel in relation to anything, right? There's one rule that exists in emotional intelligence. That's, if I know how to feel what I'm feeling and process it, I will always take responsibility for it.
Accountability.
If I don't know how to do that, I have to blame something else for how I feel, because,
right,
the energy has to go somewhere.
Right.
So
right,
if I can start learning how to feel my emotions without reacting from them, I suddenly gain a new capacity of power over self, and then command over my environment, because it comes from a more loving, empowered place. And if all of us were able to feel more, every one of us would have a conversation rather than a fight.
This is so true.
And you're getting it for free on the Ms. Drea Show. Right.
Legit.
Now. Get your
legit
life together now. You're getting your life on tonight on the Ms. Drea
wow
Show for free.
How do we get people to see what it is that we're talking about right now? To, you know what I'm
that's
saying?
That's a good
because
question.
Because there are people, I'm one of those people who, mm-hmm, I'm aware of the things that you're talking about,
mm-hmm,
and how we work together as people, and, you know, psychology and stuff like that.
Right.
So how do we get others on our level who are not, who we feel?
The first step of all of this, and this is, it's the most critical thing,
mm-hmm,
and it's the thing we overlook the most, to start this transformation, we have to be able to accept people where they are.
Say
that's
it.
True.
You
that's
got
true
to.
It's
that's
necessary.
True.
It's literally being able to go, you know what?
Okay.
It's okay that you feel that way.
Mm-hmm.
Would you like to talk about it?
Right.
Would you, why do you feel that way? And for me, you know, I grew up very independent thinking that was raised from my parents, and I was super revolutionary and activist, mm-hmm. and I swear I was going to start the revolution, and I had all this issue with oppression of society, and yes. we don't get together, we don't rebel, right? And I was in it. I was reading in books on it, I was strategizing it. And then when I had these breakthroughs of awakening, Rich, mm-hmm. I realized the truth of it, and it was, you know, and that quote that Albert Einstein says is so clear, that no problem can be solved at the level of consciousness that created it. Right? Mm-hmm. And when we hear the statement of that love is the answer, it truly is, because mm-hmm. all love is the acceptance of everything. Mm-hmm. Love is the awareness that it's okay to be and say and do anything, but uncover why, because there's something else underneath it. Mm-hmm. Right? And there's somewhere else we can go. Mm-hmm. So if we start first acknowledging that it's okay that people feel a certain way. Mm-hmm. Right? Because when you think about what the conflicts we have in the world, uh-huh. it's everyone feels the exact same way. They just think the other person's right. wrong for feeling right. that way. Right. That's it. Right. And we're so stuck on what we think we have to do or what we should do mm-hmm. that we don't ever just be for a second. Mm-hmm. Like, this person's angry. They don't know how to deal with their anger.
Right.
Right? I met a dude that he hated black people for decades, right? Wow. And he was swastikaed up and he was all in this stuff. And at this point, I got into a place in myself where I was way more at peace with who I was. So I was able to hold space for him and listen. And we just had a conversation. And at first, he was just super heated and he was like throwing dialogue. And if it was me years ago, we probably would have been fighting. But wow. since I was in a space, I just looked at him and I was like, what's hurting him so much
right.
that he thinks this is his best course of action? And so when I just listened to him and accepted him as he was, mm-hmm. by the end of our conversation, we were hugging
brothers.
And what uncovered was he had this girl that for the first time he felt all this love for, and he was vulnerable. And, you know, that's a scary thing for guys when we think that's a weak thing. But it turns out to be a source of our greatest strength. That's a whole other topic of discussion.
Mm-hmm. That's so good, though. I need to bring you
when
back.
He was in that space, it was like, oh, yeah. And then this girl left him for a black athlete. So then suddenly it was like, wow. Oh, the black that people and the athletes
envy.
And all this.
Wow.
And
no, it was like, black penis
and
envy.
It just, and then with no one there to offer him guidance on how to deal with his emotional anguish, it just exacerbated, because then he felt, so then think of that concept. Mm-hmm. He not only felt like heartbroken, he felt emasculated. Mm-hmm. He felt less than as a culture, mm-hmm. right? And he never dealt with his emotions. So then he kept finding other ways to mask it. Mm-hmm. And you know, when we attempt to avoid something by using something else, it never masks mm-hmm. it. It just makes it louder
because right, right,
it isn't being addressed. And so it just perpetuated. Then suddenly he didn't feel like he belonged where he was because he was so angry. No one bothered him. But you know who wow. accepted that anger? Another group that was angry.
Right.
And then suddenly he felt more of a brotherhood and he felt bonded, like, oh, I'm accepted here. People that share my rage.
Right.
And then we had a conversation, and finally someone that could relate to him without feeling so angry about it
right.
opened his world up to let go of his anger. Mm-hmm. And our ability to accept each other enough to provide those opportunities one person at a time, that will lead to a critical mass. That will lead to a process. You know what I mean? And that can change everything, because I even know different friends who've been in military in different countries and fought in the same wars against each other.
Wow.
And hearing their sides, they all wow. feel the same way.
Right. Yep. Everyone always feels the same way.
It's so crazy. Like, this whole system of structure is so laughable, but when we start realizing it's just people in this,
right.
it changes the game. Suddenly there's no longer this massive, monstrous power that dominates human beings. Mm-hmm. It's just human beings who haven't learned how to think consciously yet.
Oh, that's good. Now, you know, the whole time I'm sitting here, right? So I'm sitting here thinking about Brother Tyrese and how the clap back for him. And, you know, literally I was being there. Yeah. My whole thing is like, he's crying out. So I'm that's my always first thing of sitting with people and being there where they are. Yeah. And I thought that how people responded to him, what should have been the right way? It could have been a better way, a more healthier way. But a lot of people have just been really
dogging
him out yeah. and really just yeah. not embracing him. Whether he is attention seeking, he's asking for help.
Exactly.
He's crying out for help. So how do we, as a culture, as a society, you know, people feel like, oh, there's a celebrity, you got money, you have access. No, it doesn't change.
Exactly.
At all. Like, I mean, it gives you more options because you got more money. But if you're not dealing with the core of who you are, exactly. the thing spills out. You're bleeding before the people. So I would just think, instead of thinking about them, like, man, y'all need to hear that. So if you're watching, y'all need to embrace this. And y'all need to start clapping back at Tyrese, okay?
Oh, man.
I'm just thinking about Tyrese. Cause, yeah. Like, I'm really, my heart goes out to the brother. Like,
absolutely.
You know, I'm just like, dang, bro, you had a bad week and a half.
Oh.
We have challenges with that picture frame. Mm-hmm. The view, your perception determines your reception. Mm-hmm. So when you're inside the picture frame or inside that situation, your perception, your view is totally different than somebody on the outside. Mm-hmm. Unfortunately, those on the outside not having that struggle, they have a whole different mindset of how you supposed to handle that situation. Mm-hmm. Instead of thinking about how are you thinking?
Right.
So we do a lot of, one of our biggest problems is we don't know how to debate properly.
Mm-hmm.
We cuss at you, or we think that we win this subject matter by being the loudest. Mm-hmm. When actually the essence of good debating is asking how you feel.
Mm-hmm.
Get an understanding why you think the way you think.
Mm-hmm.
Then when I'm looking from your perspective, I have a better way since I've been on this other side. I know how good it is over here.
Mm-hmm.
Now I come on your side, I can guide you out of that situation.
Okay.
But we're so quick to throw rocks. Not understanding that we can be in that same situation one day.
Oh yeah.
And so it really comes down to proper communication and first getting an understanding why do they think that way?
Mm-hmm.
How did they get that way? And how can I help them out of that way?
Mm-hmm.
Because one day I might be there.
Right. For me, what hurt me the most was the public shaming of him crying and expressing, you know, his love for wanting to be a father. And to me, that hurt me the most
mm-hmm.
by seeing that, like, you know, I think it's a monotheistic way of how black masculinity plays out.
Absolutely.
And so for you only, you just hear people see diabolical and negative images of how black men express their anger, their mm-hmm. fears, their desires. I don't think it's fruitful to see one image and then even how our response to them, because like, men shut down a lot of times, you know,
exactly.
if they don't feel safe, they're going to shut down.
Exactly.
You know, so I just was thinking about all the women who just say, I'm just like, oh my gosh, no wonder your man don't talk to you. Like, I wouldn't talk to you either. Like, right. For real, that come out your mouth. Like, this, like, man, it's having a real emotion, regardless if, you know, exactly. the money dynamic, take that out of the place. It's a father that want to connect and have a relationship with his seed. Mm-hmm. And he's crying and you sitting there joking and you sitting there dogging this man out. Like, for me, that was problematic for me.
Yeah. That's huge, and I'm glad you brought that up, because what we were talking about, this next stage of us being able to feel freely is important,
mm-hmm.
right? Because we're so used to telling people, like, man up, buck up, don't be mm-hmm. crying, like, you know, it's what we heard so much, and that's why we're so unhealthy and distorted, right? Because mm-hmm. think of all the ways we find ways to mask dealing with our emotions, and
mm-hmm.
so when someone's having that moment, you know, we're in this culture now where the internet's the internet, and it has become a widespread, you know, like, impactful machine.
Oh, yeah.
Right? And there's a lot of funny stuff on it, and there's a lot of super distorted, you know, things on it, too. But it's really become this dominant factor in things, and we're so used to wanting to crack jokes and make fun because that is another way of us to, you know, like, mask our emotions and deflect things.
Mm-hmm.
And so we don't take into consideration human beings and how they feel. Like, even the people that we attack, especially when it's celebrities, and you mentioned this, we think because people are celebrities are out there that their life is okay, that they don't have issues. And it's such a funny concept, because money doesn't restore emotional intelligence.
Yeah,
you know what
no
I mean?
Different.
Like, yes, money is awesome. It's a dynamic in our life. It gives us opportunities and there's a way to live it in a healthy state. But your emotions and how you process that, how you relate yourself to other people, makes all the difference in a world. And you see that because people who have a lot of money, you see when they're unhappy.
Oh, yeah.
Right? And that's what I love. Like, Jim Carrey's cool. What Jim Carrey's doing right now in life is
right.
awesome. Where he, like, that quote he had when he said, I wish people could have everything they ever desire so they can realize it isn't the answer.
Yeah.
I just want to.
You know what I mean?
This is just, it's on my mind right now. Because you were talking about Tyrese.
Mm-hmm.
And we're talking about feminization of the black man. And I don't think that, you know, the people who has something to say, oh, as far as him getting on there and making the video, I don't think it was I'm coming down on you.
Mm-hmm.
It's tough love to say, look at you right now putting this out here like this, crying. You know what I'm saying? I feel your pain.
Mm-hmm.
I know you're hurting. I know. I can imagine. You know what I'm saying? Whether I'm going through it or not, it's a lot of people who are going through it. Mm-hmm. It's a lot of people who don't know what it looks like.
Mm-hmm.
But you cannot get on there and you cry like this, and I get it, but then you come off as weak to me. You come off as weak to me because you are, at the end of the day, you're a figure, you're a public figure. Mm-hmm. And me as a regular person, you know, all these people, they're looking at you to, regardless of what people think, at the end of the day, you are human, but people look at you differently, okay? Mm-hmm. And when we're talking about being strong and being a man, and it's so much that you have to endure, man, woman, whatever, but being a man, mm-hmm. and you're going through this battle, to me, mm-hmm. to me, and from what I understood from, you know, certain comedians, whether they made a joke out of it or what, you cannot come off as weak. I don't care if you're on your last leg. Do not let anyone know that you are on your last leg. That, I think that was like, I mean, because at that point, when you get on there crying like that, you're feminizing yourself. I'm like, are you kidding me right now? I heard it over the phone before I even knew that it was posted. And I'm like, oh, turn it off. I can't hear him crying like that, you know, because it's like, it's painful. It's painful. And it's not a joke. And I hear people are laughing, but it's painful to hear him wailing out like that. You are a man, a grown man. I'm not saying you can't hurt. I'm just saying.
So what do you think happens? Right. So what do you think happens when a person internalize all their human emotions?
Don't internalize it. That's not what I'm telling you to do either. I'm just telling you to pick and choose your battles. It's a way to deal with everything. You know, I don't have to go out and yell in the middle of the highway for my message to get heard, is what I'm saying.
So his level of transparency and him using his platform to bring awareness to his situation, you feel like it was misguided, misused?
I feel like it was done totally wrong.
Okay.
You could have addressed so much to the situation that you're going through. It's how many black men are going through something, you know what I'm saying? Whether they did something to the child, the mother, or not.
Right.
How many black men are going through the same situation? Black men, white men, I don't care what kind of man.
Mm-hmm.
How many men are going through the same thing?
Mm-hmm.
You could have brought awareness to a totally
different,
you know, a bigger situation, your situation in a bigger a matter that is bigger than you. But no, you try to bring awareness to just you. You know what I'm saying? You could have capitalized off of I don't know.
Do you feel like he was his approach to it was more about just getting attention for him rather than actually
I feel like it was sincere, and I feel like to a certain extent because there's nothing in me that's gonna, and I'm a woman. Yeah. And I'm not gonna, you know, I'm not gonna feel myself crying for one. Cause how sad am I to, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
I don't want you to know that if I was crying before I got here in my car, I would not come here and let you see that my eyes are red. You know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. I don't want you to know that, because then I'm appearing weak. And if I'm weak, that means I'm at my weakest point, right? I'm showing you. I don't even care what happened right now, girl.
I have another perspective.
Me too.
I
think we share the same perspective.
I would say there's people you're supposed to trust to show your weaknesses too.
But when you
put yourself out like that, then you're subject to receive whatever they desire to return back to you, and that might not be good for you.
I'm saying. But that's just me, though. Right. I'm really like that. I wouldn't really want you to know if I was crying. Mm-hmm. I don't care how close we are, because it's just me. Mm-hmm. So if I could look at me like that, and I know how sensitive I am, and I see this grown man right here, sir.
But see, with that,
sir, I get it. It's
too much estrogen.
But just, you know, you have to know who you can confide in, because everybody is not your friend, and that's what you got.
That's what you got.
Well, that's what you feel like you got. But the people who I feel like are making videos, they being real with you. One thing, whether you like it or not, they telling you, you know what I'm saying? Don't do that. And whether you like how they saying it, hey, it is what it is. You know, it's tough love, but somebody got to tell you, be careful.
I personally would have went out like that. I would have articulate my challenge, because I want to, you know, I'm having this problem, but I know I can become, I can feel better if I'm giving out information to help another person.
Right.
So, hey, I'm telling you, don't fall into the same hellhole as I did.
Right.
Let me give you some advice so you cannot fall into this ditch.
Right.
Like using more purposefully.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So.
But what if tears come out and you conveying that? Like you've that.
It's fine. It's fine. The tears come out, but let the tears have a purpose.
Okay.
Yeah, that everyone that listened to it, they say, you know, he was sincere. He was deep about it. And he gave me an answer
And saying that I'm not the only man suffering these kind of challenges. There's a lot of men across the board here who's not being vocal. So I want to be vocal on their behalf, but I want you to know I'm a man, but I do have feelings too.
Yes. Right.
And I do have emotions, and sometimes a challenge to put in the right place.
Right. Mm-hmm.
But there's men out there with these challenges, and they having to bottle in, and sometimes because they bottle it in too long, they become abusive with it.
Right.
We need to learn how to let the steam out properly.
Mm-hmm.
And part of it's a psychological thing, part of it's a diet. Mm-hmm. There's so many aspects that affect us mm-hmm. in our relationships, and physical, mentally, all of that. And mm-hmm. we got to learn how to be knowledgeable in those categories mm-hmm. and balance it properly. Because
that shame and guilt piece, when it comes to being a part, it comes abuse. You know, I've seen situations where, like, I've always been that kind of girl. Thank God, that's my gift. You know, that being in spaces with men, they feel safe enough to, you know, share, you know, and have expressed emotions. Yeah. But I've seen it with some men because they never had the outlet, because it told us, you know, that's you a punk, you ain't a girl, that when they have felt safe enough with their partner, and then they start resenting them because now they feel like, oh, she think I'm soft from this and this and that.
Yeah.
And she don't think I'm a man, and he always trying to overcompensate. Mm-hmm. You know, him being a man, I'm this macho, and all of a sudden, now he beating her to the head to the white meat because he has to feel like that's the only way to show that he's a man, because of the fact I saw you, you know, I looked at you, you made it look at me differently because I cried and I couldn't stop crying. I couldn't know why I couldn't stop crying. And now you saw me crying. Now I got to make sure you know that I'm a man. So we need to have more conversations that men can feel safe to be men and know that, yes, being angry, enraged, sometimes tears, that is a human emotion. Mm-hmm. And it has nothing to do with gender.
Right.
It's a basic human emotion.
Right.
And so that's for me. That was my whole component, because when I seen a little 9 or 11-year-old kid to say that it's okay, like, you guys are tripping, it's okay for a father to say that he wants to have a relationship with his child. And if it does, if they cry, it lets me know as a child that my father does love me.
Right.
You
right.
know, so
right.
it just depends on the one's perception and how they view that conversation piece. So that was just my whole little spiel on that one. So it's okay, man. You know, I don't want nobody beat me in the head over the white meat talking about he because he a man. No, let's have a conversation.
You a man. We know you emotions. A man. You look
okay,
like a man.
You know what I'm saying? Like, I know that you are, I know that you're a man, you know, so.
Well, you know, and with that, and what you're sharing, it's an interesting perspective here, because I'm so familiar with that mm-hmm. perspective, you know, and most of my life it was that mentality for me. And what I've, doing the work that I've done now and the way my life's changed with this practice and for others, realizing how vulnerability is actually the source of our greatest strength.
Mm-hmm.
And the more that we learn to step into it, we recognize it, because all vulnerability is, like actual vulnerability, not like, say, if I'm in a dark alley and there's 5, 6, 7 people
right,
and I'm
right,
physically
right,
in
right.
danger
right.
vulnerability, but the vulnerability of emotional right. and me being a person, it becomes the source of our greatest strength, because it is literally our open, honest expression of self.
Right.
And if you can live in the freedom of your own expression, there is nothing suppressed, there is nothing mm-hmm. misaligned, there is nothing distorted. And then in that same context, there's nothing anyone can use against you.
That's good.
And that changes everything. Because think of all the, like, higher powers that when something came out, it was like tabloids and all these things. And then they're mm-hmm. like, they want to retract their steps. Oh, well, okay. I just, you know, whatever. But if they accepted themselves enough and were vulnerable enough,
mm-hmm.
they just, like anyone else, they would get up there and they'd be like, and then you did this. And they'd be like, yeah.
And then leave it at that. Right.
Exactly. They'd be like,
right.
yeah. And then everyone would be like, okay. You know, what are you going to say?
Clearly, I don't think that took place in this situation because he came back and did some other video that was kind of trying to change the view.
Exactly. So clearly he hadn't developed that skill set.
Right. So he's not like you.
No.
Well, his complication was what he did in the past, too, toward what he said about black women and other people.
Oh, yeah, that's what women
were saying. So all that adds up. Like, oh, you've been a hypocrite. Oh, you, who cares? Because we already know how you're thinking. So who cares?
Right.
So
I know self-hate is real. And we talk about that component. So there's layers up to who he is
mm-hmm.
that I think he's seeking, that hopefully he will get to a level of self-awareness and knowing thyself, and that he will get to a place of healing and wholeness mm-hmm. and be comfortable where he is. Because he felt like when you made that comment saying that the reason why you don't date black women for all these toxic things, of course, when we see everything in our culture where it talks about black men or black women, mm-hmm. it's so toxic, it's so negative that you start believing those things. So you feel like,
exactly.
so because, you know, white womanhood has always been elevated. It's like, you know, the white is just perfect. Like, you know, white womanhood is esteemed. So he feels like, okay, anything outside of a black woman, a him have a better experience, and he's having the same experience because women are women. It doesn't matter right. what ethnic component, women are women. Mm-hmm. And so he has to come to terms with that, because that's him and his self-hate and those things that he's accepted and he's internalized. He has to work exactly. through that point. And so that's why black women have come on him and really ate him a new one, because how he shamed, publicly shamed black womanhood. He comes right. from the black womb. And so that black hurt is like hurt people. So I yeah. wanted to throw that out there. Like, black women was really going in on him because of that. Like, you thought that was right. You should have. Yeah, but whatever. Love is love to me. You know, love is love. So whatever.
Did you
yeah.
have something you
wanted
to say?
Well, yeah, because, I mean, I love what you just shared. This idea of, like, the black culture, for instance, right? I'm multiracial, right? Mm-hmm. So I have, and my dad's black, my mom's white, and grew up in Colorado. And in the 90s, you know, there was still a huge volatile issue about, you know, interracial mm-hmm. dating. And so as a kid, I used to get told all the time how I wasn't supposed to exist, right? Wow. Because it's like, yeah. you're not supposed to be together. You shouldn't be here.
Right.
And it was like, what? So I was really angry growing up, right? Because then I felt like I had to prove myself being light-skinned and being,
oh, I know,
you know,
like
this stuff, right? So I was always angry and fighting more, just like to show I matter, that significance, right?
Right?
And
I know
so,
that feeling.
And then you think of the nature of our culture, where because we've been so displaced, mm-hmm. right? And what you were just sharing a moment ago, brother, was this idea of a lack of sense of self.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean? And for whatever our history once was, it was stripped away.
Mm-hmm.
And in that, so did a sense of self that we wanted to find. So then think of the idea of the black man in itself being a strong figure, right? Mm-hmm. Just an appearance alone, a strong mm-hmm. figure, because of the nature of the archetype.
Mm-hmm.
Yet in a culture where you feel that and want to be that, but you're constantly getting beat down. Like during the slavery mm. era, all you'd ever do was get, you know, like destroyed.
Yeah.
And then how do you then wake up the next day and still feel stronger?
Yeah. Right.
And so then slavery ended, right? Mm-hmm. And then that, and but the emotional wounds
still
didn't.
They, no, they
linger.
Just,
yeah.
Right? And
you
so then our culture still is hard. It's like, so when you see, like the idea of a black man being articulate. My dad was, he was born in Bowling Green, Kentucky, right?
Okay.
And so everyone talks super country, and he wanted to speak more articulate. And so he actually started like working on that for himself.
Mm-hmm.
And rather than people say like, wow, you're, you know, I love the way you talk, very educated on stuff. They're like, oh, what are you trying to be white? You know,
oh,
like that whole,
yeah.
that dynamic. And
yeah,
it was like,
it too.
And that concept to me is just so interesting,
it's
because
creepy.
It's like, I didn't know that
proper.
Speaking intelligent was the, you know, confided to a race.
Basic grammar.
Yeah.
You know,
and and so in that struggle within us in these cultural archetypes is mm-hmm. like, that's what we are learning how to work through first, because
oh, yeah.
that's that distortion alone leads to comments like Tyrese made about black women and that, mm-hmm. and then experiencing that. And yes, he's getting the reciprocation of his feeling,
mm-hmm.
but he didn't even know what was underneath why he would say that.
Say right. that.
You know what I mean? And it's this right. lack of self-awareness right. in most, you know, different societies, but then definitely in the black culture, that messes us up.
Yeah, because right. we don't have the core back. You know, when you
yeah.
when you're stripped of your history, your culture, mm-hmm. your religious totems, your everything, you're left to have to build up what your oppressor gave to you and said, mm-hmm. this is finite, so this is universal. But yeah, I know you about to say something.
No,
Dr.
I was just listening. I was just
yeah.
soaking all of that up.
Yeah,
that was,
so,
what
yeah.
you say is paramount to get mm-hmm. understanding of your history.
Because
mm-hmm. exactly. we live in a time of fake news.
Mm-hmm.
And that fake news have you going left to the right.
Mm-hmm.
Because of the field I work in,
mm-hmm.
I always try to tell people when they listen to the our regular news mm-hmm. media, I call it the media, I call it the mainstream bias.
Mm-hmm.
And because I hear so much talked upon that it's not true.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Whether it's a Republican or Democrat, whatever it may be,
mm-hmm.
that entity is owned by six owners.
Mm-hmm.
And they dictate what you listen to
mm-hmm.
and how you listen to it.
Mm-hmm.
So I always tell people, go beyond what they say. As one great journalist said, it's not what they say, it's what they did not say that
exactly.
we need to pay attention to.
Mm-hmm.
So it's vital to go beyond what they say to research.
Mm-hmm.
So for us to even get a start to move forward, like the brother here shared earlier, we got to get an understanding of our real history, where we come from, what we're made of.
Mm-hmm.
You know, we just know about Martin Luther King, Rosa Parks, and that's about it. But most everything we use in our household and streets
mm-hmm.
and such
black
is invented by black people. But how many of our kids know about that?
And can I say, our history started before the transatlantic slave trade.
Right.
Exactly. And same thing as Christianity. But right. You got to open a book and you got to read it and understand right. that it is not the white man's religion. Right. The way it was represented and reduplicated, yeah, it was used to docile the slave. But so mm-hmm. definitely, you got to yeah. go back to your history and you got to read books, more than one book. How about that? To right. to expand our base and knowing that the totality of who we are as a people, as a human race.
Correct.
Yeah.
Correct.
So. Yeah.
Well, guys, I would like to thank you for joining us in this heavy discussion that we had tonight. But I think we got a lot, you know, as far as information and thoughts and our views. I think we put that out there. Mm-hmm. I would like to thank all of the guests who came.
Oh, yeah, that's a phenomenal
yeah,
guest.
Yeah, and the verbiage that was just. You know, laid out on the table. It was excellent. I'd like to thank all of the viewers for watching tonight. I'd like to thank the entire Universe Miami Network platform for allowing us to be here. I would like to thank my Model Gang family. I would like to thank my beautiful co-hosts for joining me each and every Thursday. I would like to thank the one and only AD for putting this thing together. I would like to thank Steve for helping us out.
Hey, Steve. White boy Steve, we love
you. Yvonne and David, Tyrone and Kevin. I would like to thank all of you, Davika. Yes. Demetra was on my mind.
Yes, you know, it's still Scorpio season, so we still celebrating our birthday. Shout out to my mom who had two sets of British Britannicas in our house, considering the conversation tonight. Read a book, and read more books. So I just wanted to share that and throw that to make it light of, you know, the night that we had tonight. So again, shout out to the One of Twin supporters, to Davi Speaks. It is always a blessing to be on the platform with this young, dynamic woman and artist. So I'm just humble and grateful to be here.
Thank you. It has been a pleasure sitting in front of you. We look forward to seeing you next week, Thursday at 8. Good night.